Santa Claus does. Toys and candy and eggs and all kinds of stuff. I had to think back when the young folks were here reciting at Easter, because Easter was a good time for us too. I hated those feasts and trying to remember them. I used to even hide them, but somehow my mother had a tracking ability that the FBI could use. Didn't make any difference where I hid it, she would find it. In time for me to learn it, in time to be at church on the right schedule. But the good thing about it was when you finished, you got this half-pound coconut-filled chocolate-covered Easter egg. And then the church is starting to get poor and move from a half-pound to a quarter-pound and then an eighth of a pound. That was Easter. Folks dressed up and celebrating. But there's another side to Easter that we don't pay a lot of attention to. Easter is one of the most confusing holidays because nothing seems to be clear. Stop and think about it. If we were doing a show on CSI and we were trying to track the evidence, what would you really find out? Well, you've got four folks who are telling the story. Bits and pieces are similar, but all the stories are different. If you go to Luke, he tells the story that folks think Mary Ann came to the tomb early that morning. Two Marys and Johanna, and they came and they knew that Jesus had to be covered with spice because that he had come down and they brought him down from the cross too quickly for that to be done on Friday. So they had to go and wash and provide the right spices for his body. But when they got there, they were astonished. They were astonished because his body wasn't there. What had happened to him? Who had taken him out of there? They did not know. When asked, said, well, we look for Jesus. He said, why are you looking for him here among the dead? He's not here. He's already risen. Did he tell you he was going to do that? You can almost look with a skeptical eye at the folks who were standing at that point, because even Mary, his mother, was saying, raised up from the dead. Who ever heard of anybody being raised from the dead? Although Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead, the story says. But what evidence did they have that this is what happened to Jesus? How would they know? Well, they took the word back anyway because they wanted so much for this to be true. They went back and told Peter, and they came running to see what was going on. Was this really so? Then, if you turn to another account, John says that the two Marys came. And when they got there, the huge stone that had been put in front of the entrance to make sure that nobody messed with the body had been moved. And when they got there, they found that the stone had been removed. She saw a man standing there and she said, well, they have taken Jesus. And we don't know where they've laid him. Mystified, said, but why are you looking for him here? He's already gone. They looked in and the linen wrappings that had been around his body were all in a pile. The cloth that had been laid over his head was in another place. Surely somebody came in and unwrapped him, took the cloth off of his face and set it up in another place, and then took his body on out. You know, the difficulty we've already found out with eyewitnesses is you get four up together and you'd have five stories. talking with them and asked them, after they had said what they were looking for, where is he? What has happened to him? And Jesus standing right nearby, they looked around and there he was. The angels had been one at the head, one at the foot, waiting to see what the response was going to be, perhaps. Still mystified. If you gathered that much information, what did happen to Jesus? Mark says that Mary Magdalene and his mother came thinking that they were going to be able to do what needed to be done, but when they got there, they found that he wasn't there. And they too were mystified because they couldn't find out what had happened to him. What had happened to Jesus of Nazareth? Then, of course, they were told that he had been raised from the dead. Go tell Peter about it. Well, of course, in the first version, in the first version of John, they had gone running back to tell him to come and see what they had found out. Matthew tells even a different kind of story. Matthew says that Mary Magdalene and Mary came to the tomb, and when they got there, angels descended from heaven. And this brightly clothed angels rolled the stone away while they were standing there and then sat on it. And said, "Who are you looking for?" We're looking for Jesus who was crucified. Well, he's not here. He's already gone. Go tell the disciples that he's on his way to Galilee and that he'll meet them there. So they went running back. But then in the meantime, if they turned to go running back, they were greeted along the road by Jesus. What can we believe? What kind of evidence tells us that these stories are true? Then, of course, later on, the gospel writers tell us that he went on and appeared before Magdalene, Mary Magdalene, and then he went to see the disciples in the upper room and talked to them for a while, and Thomas, who wasn't even with the crowd, said, "You know, I don't even believe anything you want to tell me." And probably the official high priest didn't believe it either. Said, "You know, these are his fanatics. They just want us to believe that something happened." Matthew says that when the guards who were guarding the tomb saw the stone being rolled away by this angel, they were dumbfounded. I don't think they were dumbfounded, they were just scared. I know if I was standing there and somebody rolled a huge stone away right in front of me, I would be scared. I don't want to know what the hell. Who in the world is this? But when they went to tell the high priest what was going on, the high priest said, "Don't you tell Pilate that story. You tell Pilate that story, you're going to be in trouble. Tell him that they came and paid you some money and his followers took the body away. But he'll accept that. Or maybe even they overpowered you and took it away. But that's a better story than that an angel descended and rolled the rock away and sat on it while you looked in and saw that Jesus was already gone." And Thomas, just like some of the soldiers, said, "You saw Jesus in the upper room, I don't believe it. With this territory, it's just not good." Said, "I got to feel it for myself." So he put his hand, Jesus came and said, "Come on, Thomas, touch me." Found his question in his hands and in his side. Said, "My Lord and my Master." Somebody looking at that would have said, it was in the movies, would have said, "I don't know what kind of wine he was drinking." His followers just want us to believe that it's more to it than what we already believe. He's already dead, we crucified him and he's gone. But here we are, 2,000 years later, and don't think they haven't been hunting for his body. They've been hunting for his body 2,000 years and still haven't found him. No traces of him. Then, of course, there are those stories circulating around that he and Mary Magdalene got together, got married, and they had some children, and their children were running around in Europe as kings and queens. Then there are those who would say that some of the orders that have been providing leadership, secret societies providing leadership down through the centuries, have really been descendants of Jesus and Mary. They had a son, and his son started another organization. It has had a long history. So what do you believe? There's no evidence anywhere that anybody could put their hand on that said Jesus really came up out of the grave. So why Easter? Why do we celebrate this resurrection that folks said happened so long ago? There's no physical evidence. There's no written evidence. There's nothing you can put your hand on. And yet we know that Jesus is.
All right.
Hope. All the scientists in the world can't prove it. But we know that Jesus is. We know that Jesus is because Jesus is our friend. We know that Jesus is because Jesus has walked with us. You see, we know Jesus is alive because Jesus is super bad. Not super bad. Jesus is super bad.
Yes, sir.
There ain't nothing Jesus can do. There's even a dark side to this. When you're caught in those situations that you can find no light in and no hope in, Jesus is standing right there saying, "Come on, let's get on out of here." And he will show you a way through.
Amen.
Because you see, Jesus is that kind of friend.
Amen.
And the truth of the matter is, Jesus ain't a fair weather friend. Jesus will be with you knowing that you ain't no good. And the Bible says, everyone is born a sinner.
Yeah.
And folks didn't want to classify, well, you know, their big sins and their little sins. So I'm a little sinner, but you're a big sinner. Your sin is bigger than mine. But I would say, all of us.
All.
Nobody escapes that brush. All of us are born in sin.
Yes.
And yet Jesus is sitting right there. Is that what they got so upset about? Jesus would sit with sinners. He would sit with the publicans. He would sit with the Pharisees. He would sit with the tax collectors to make him no difference. Jesus would sit down with anybody.
Yes.
Because Jesus was a friend.
Yes.
How do we know that Jesus is alive?
Well,
we don't have any scientific evidence, no. But we know that Jesus is alive because of his grace. Jesus embraces us. It's the grace that embraces us, not because of who we are, or what we are, simply because we are.
Yes.
It's like grace has become a person. Just walks up to us and wraps us up no matter what. We live in a world that is so full of stuff that we can get caught up. But appreciate and understand that we live in a worthy world.
Yes.
We get rewarded not because of what we've done, not because of what we deserve, but simply because of God's mercy.
Yes.
See, that's what Jesus means. Jesus says it don't make me no difference where you are and what you've been doing. I love you because you are a child of God.
Amen.
And you can't earn it. There's nothing you can do. You're not worth it. Because if you got paid back what you deserved, you wouldn't even be here. But Jesus says, don't worry about it. They're here because God loves. I represent God's love today, and I'm right here with him. Jesus is the point. He stands and says, come to me. There's nowhere else to go. Come to me. Come to me, because if you want to understand what life is really all about, come to me. You're not going to find out what life is like out there. You're not going to find out what life is like over there. If you want to really know what life is like, what it really means to have relationships, if you really want to know what it means to have love, come to me. Because in me, you fullness of life. Come to me. It says if you come to me, Jesus says, you'll be happy. You'll be happy if you come to me. Because I've come to give you good news of great joy.
Yeah.
You're not trapped to your all by yourself. You can't walk through this all by yourself. You can't walk into another life all by yourself. I've come to tell you that not only does God love you, but God has already been walking with you, preserving you, guiding you, and will open up a door so that if you will stay in me, he will provide for you a life eternal.
Yes.
This is only a sojourn, a brief period. This wears out. But if you are in me, I can make you happy for eternity. You will learn the real meaning of life. And you will be happy. Jesus is with us and for us. That's how we know that he's alive. That's how we know that he's here.
Yeah.
Because he's the one who embodies love and helps us to understand what love is really all about. You see, Jesus in Easter helps us to understand love ain't about us. It's about what we're willing to sacrifice for others. See, Jesus could just as easily say, hey, take me down off the street. I've had enough of this stuff. They haven't beat me all night. Then they started putting thorns on my head. They put nails in my hands. Nail in my foot. And now I'm left up here in the scorching sun to die. I don't need all of this. But enjoy it. It wasn't about him. It was what he was doing for us. See, what Jesus was doing and why we know he's alive is because he set for us the pattern of life. We live when we share and looking at how we promote and nurture others, not ourselves. See, the love that Jesus shared, not for himself, the worry that he shared was not for himself. The concern that he shared was not for himself. The message that he had was not for himself. It was for us. And he was willing to give it all up for us. Jesus is here. He is the one that's trying to help us to understand that all is well when we trust in him. That he's alive. where they walked up and pushed the stone away. And if you turn to page 6, you'll see the pictures that they took in the tomb when he was dead. No, we can't do any of that. That's the scientific evidence. But what we've got is the empirical evidence. What we feel, how we know. When he reaches down into the depths of our illness and says, here I am, and I've got a cure for what ails you. How do you position? There's no disease can hide itself from. You love me? I'm the one that can walk in. And when you walk with me, you have companionship today, tomorrow, and always. You feel like you're in love? Put your hand in mouth. And feel my pulse. And you know that you are loved. You are loved completely. There's nothing that you can do to earn it. It's given to you freely. See, that's how I know Jesus is alive. I've been through the whole exercise of life. You can read about it, you can study about it, you can talk about it, you can even preach about it. But wait till you walk face to face into it.
All right.
And then everything takes on a whole new meaning. It's no longer up here, it's down here.
Yeah.
When it gets down here, ain't nothing they can tell you. It's nothing you can see. It's nothing that you can read in a book. You know Jesus is alive. But he's right here. He's lifting you up. He's powering your step. He's guiding your life. He's watching over you. He wants you to be complete and happy. That's when you know he's alive. When you're walking and talking with him. What does the evidence show? No scientific study doesn't say nothing. But the empirical evidence, what you feel, says, yeah, Jesus is alive. He came out of that tomb. He's alive even today, 2,000 years later. He's right here, moving around this, saying, worship me, talk with me, talk with me. And I'm here for you. I'm alive. Don't forget sometimes.